Bernard, is it okay with you?
Yep, it's okay with me.
Okay, so then today we have Bernard Lidický, and now I'm guessing from the title that Bernard will be talking about some mixture of geometry and maybe something else. We will see. So Bernard, please go ahead.
Thank you for inviting me to this webinar series, and thank you for running it, especially when everything was in lockdown. It was a great event. I'll be speaking about joint work with József Balogh, who is a professor at University of Illinois, and Felix Christian Clemen, who is his graduate student. During normal seminars, if you have a seminar at your institution, you invite the speaker there, they give talk, and then you show them around. And I saw in one of these online talks, Corey Palmer did the opposite, where the speaker took the audience to a tour where he was. So I'll maybe show you where I am as a bonus start of the talk. So I am at Iowa State University. This is a map of United States. Here is Iowa, and I am right here in the middle of Iowa. There is some small town called Ames. Just in case you don't know where Iowa is. If you didn't know, I don't blame you. I was a postdoc right here in Urbana-Champaign, and I didn't know where Iowa is for 2 years until they had a conference that we drove to. And then I forgot where it was again until I got interviewed. So anyway, so this is Iowa. This is how our campus looks like. This is typical university town. So we have like this big lawn. We have second lawn. This in the middle kind of is the math department building. Oh, it's a building that has many classrooms. The math department is on the top floor. The building is about 60 years old. And it was built during budget crisis. It seems to me that in higher education, there is always budget crisis, something that I learned. So because there was budget crisis, it was built with expected lifespan 50 years. There are no money to replace it. So anyway, it's all right. Some entertainment in Ames. Right? We have beach. This is our city beach. You can, and if you come visit here in the summer, I'll take you to a sand beach. If you come in the winter, there is skiing. We have a lot of sunny days, so it doesn't snow that much, but they make snow. In the winter, it gets cold. It's not actually downhill skiing. It looks like it, but it's down to a hole skiing. The land is flat and there is a canyon, so you ski down to a hole. If you don't like skiing, there is snow tubing. You can go down the snow tubes, and here it goes around 60 kilometers per hour. No skill required. And I have a few more entertainments. Iowa is great for kayaking, or if you like car racing, there is a dirt racetrack 20 minutes away from Ames. It's cultural experience. You can get things like deep fried Oreos. And last slide for Iowa entertainment. We have a winery in town. It's not particularly good because the wine doesn't taste that good and it's expensive, but we have a winery and we are better for breweries. There are places that have like 100 beers on tap and you can buy a yearly pass and you go there and every time you come, they give you a different beer. So if you like beer, Iowa is a little bit better. Right, so that was this little Iowa entertainment advertisement. And here, let's look at the problem that I'll try to talk about. Okay, so here is a problem. We'll have T, a fixed triangle. So here is a triangle T. Okay? And we will fix n, which is some natural number. And now the question is, you can pick n points in the plane, and you would like to find as many triangles that are similar to D and these points. Okay? So there are, here are some triangles, every triple of them points that we pick here. For, I picked some points P, every triple is a triangle, and I would like to find configuration that maximizes the number of triangles that are similar to the triangle T. Okay? And here, what do you mean? What do I mean by similar, maybe? So I say that two triangles are epsilon similar if their inner angles differ by at most epsilon. So what you could do is that you can move the triangle T around, and you can rotate it, you can scale it, and you can wiggle it a little bit. So maybe the problem has some epsilon bigger than zero that is fixed. But we would like to have some kind of result that works for any fixed epsilon. So we will a little bit hide it, but there is some small epsilon. Okay. Here are some examples. This green triangle is similar to the triangle T. This other green triangle is also epsilon similar to the triangle T. And then maybe this red triangle is not epsilon similar. I know the green ones are epsilon similar because I drew it that way. I mean, they are not exact. They are like 1 degree off or something like that. So maybe if you take epsilon that is small enough, they will not be epsilon similar anymore. Yeah. Right. Maybe I'll recap the definitions. Okay. So we had this thing that two triangles, T and T prime, here, just to make sure, are epsilon similar. If I look at the angles that are here, I have to draw gamma. Okay. And if the angles are ordered in this way, then the differences of these angles in absolute value are always less than epsilon. And so this would be example of two similar ones. And only thing that matters are the interior angles of the triangle. Okay? So I guess this is, if you forget this definition, it will not be very useful talk. And then the thing that we are trying to investigate is this maximum number of triangles in a planar set of n points that are similar, epsilon similar to triangle T. So this h and t epsilon is the number of triangles that you can obtain that are epsilon similar. So parameters are the number of points, the triangle, and the little wiggle room that you have. Okay. And the question of maximizing the number of epsilon similar triangles in the plane is by Bárány and Füredi from 2019 that asked, if you are given a triangle and n, try to find the point set. Okay. Right. So let's look at lower bound construction. Okay. So here is a possibility what you can do. So here is the triangle T, and here is some n, maybe here n equals 27. Okay. And what I could do is partition the vertices into three sets that are about equal size. Okay. And then I would hope that if they are small enough, kind of, then whenever I pick a triple, that each of them is in different of part of this three partition, I will get a triangle T prime that is epsilon similar to the triangle T. And then inside, one can do the same thing, kind of recursively. In each of these blobs, I partition it into three equal parts. And I hope that whenever I pick a triple, such that each vertex is from a different blob, I get a triangle that is similar to the triangle T. Here you can kind of say, right, there was this epsilon fixed. What happens if epsilon gets smaller? If epsilon gets smaller, you can kind of squeeze this construction a little bit more to make it a little smaller, push it farther away. So it's like, yeah. Now it got a little bit more tight. I compressed it a little bit. So still the same parts, right? But now the angles between them got a little bit tighter. Right? And so one gets this iterated kind of construction, right? A kind of recursive construction. It appears in extremal graph theory in different places as well. For example, if you try to maximize the number of induced five cycles over ordinary graphs, the best thing to do is to take an iterated blow-up of a five cycle. So it appears in inducibility a lot. It is a result by Jacob Fox, Chung-Bum Lee, and Hao Huang, independently by Ralph Huster, that if you pick a random graph, then the graph that maximizes the number of induced copies of this random graph G is an iterated blow-up of the graph G. So almost all graphs, if you want to maximize the number of induced copies of them, is some recursive structure like that. And there is a result by Alexander Rasborov and Drew Mubai that uses this iterated structure for tournaments on four vertices to show that to bound how quickly some Ramsey numbers grow. So it also has some other applications. So anyway, what I was trying to show that say is that these iterated constructions are appear naturally and sometimes have applications. So this construction gives something. I have these three blobs, and I say one has size A, one has size B, the last one has size C. So the number of epsilon similar triangles that you get is ABC, which are the triangles that go across, plus whatever is inside. Right? So this is the recursive formula for it. And you can try to solve it, and you will get that this formula gives about one quarter of all possible triples. Right? So one quarter of all triples of points will create a triangle that is epsilon similar to T. There is little trash, because if you don't have something that you can balance, if I don't have something that is power of three as the number of points, then at some point I will have to have little unbalancedness. Yeah. So this is this. But if you are a power of three, you can nicely iterate the construction and everything goes nicely and get 1/24 n³ - n. Okay. And this now creates a lower bound for the maximum number of epsilon similar triangles in T. Right? So for every triangle T, I can do this construction and get at least one quarter of all the triples. Okay. So this is lower bound construction. Yeah. This thing was observed by Bárány and Füredi, so it's a little bit of history. Here I am just saying the construction of the previous slide. Bárány and Füredi say that the iterated blow-up of the triangle itself gives you one quarter. And they show that if T is an equilateral triangle, like the one that has all the sides the same, then you get equality, that you cannot do better than this iterated blow up of the triangle itself. Okay. So for equilateral triangles, you get is exactly the right extremal construction. But sometimes you can do better. So here will be example where you can do better. So let's say I have this triangle T and it has a feature that here is right angle and these two sides have the same length. Okay? And if you have a triangle like this, then this is a better construction. Okay, just on five vertices, but you can do a blow up and iterate it. Okay? And if you look then, this would be a copy of the triangle T. Okay, here I have four copies that look like this, but also there are the big ones. Right? So you get a lot. Right? Lot of, the triple that will not look like T is this triple and this triple. Right? They don't really look like triangles much. Right? But all the other reasonable ones, they'll give you a copy of T. And so here is the observation that if you have an isosceles right angle triangle, then the maximum number of copies of the triangle T that you can get is like 0.414. Right? So much more than one quarter. It was the iterated construction. Okay? And there are other triangles where you can get strictly more than the iterated blow up. Right? If you have just right angle triangles, right, then you could do a rectangle, right, like this. And then if you have a rectangle, then like every triple will create a triangle that is similar to triangle T, which you cannot do if you have a general triangle. You cannot have 4 points that every triple will give you. But sometimes the right angle makes it that you can gain. Right. But most of the time, you cannot gain. So Bárány and Füredi have a result that for almost every triangle T, you can get upper bound 0.5072. And with Joji and Felix, we have a slight improvement that instead of this 0.72, we can just say the 1/4 is the right thing for almost every triangle. Right? And here is some, you know, for every triangle, there is this epsilon zero bigger than zero. Then if this epsilon is small enough, then you get only the 1/4. Right? If you have something that would be almost the isosceles triangle and epsilon zero would be big enough, then you could still maybe fit it into the big rectangle or something like that. Right? But as the epsilon gets smaller, then eventually the big rectangle will fail. All right. I'll say what I mean by almost every in a minute. First, I'll do entertaining pictures of the co-authors. So this is Joži Balogh. He is showing what the equilateral triangle looks like. He's on a Hungarian national TV show for young mathematicians. It's something like Riskuj, very entertaining to watch. There is a recording if you are very interested and speak a little bit Hungarian. And here is Felix. I had entertaining picture of Felix, but he asked that I put a professional looking one. He's graduating in the spring. And he will be going to, I think it's called KIT, it's in Germany, as a postdoc for Mária Aksenovič. He's a nice guy, yeah, he's fun to hang out, he's also smart, works hard. If you have chance, bring him over. I hope you will not regret. I enjoy working with him a lot. Anyway, so those are our at the counters. Here, so almost every triangle. Right? So here, some tricks from Bárány and Füredi. So what they observed that you can identify triangles with points with complex numbers. So I will maybe do it by picture. Here I have some triangle T. Yeah. It has some vertices X, Y, Z. Yeah. And here is the here are the real numbers. And I will say zero is one important point. One is another important point. And then I will pick two of these. One of them I will map to zero. The other one I map to one. And then I will put X such that I get a triangle T that is epsilon similar. That is similar, that is like just scaled. Right? I can scale T and make it such that Y, Z are 0, 1. Maybe I'll draw it like this. Y goes to 0, Z goes to 1. Right? And now, where is X? X has two options. Right? Either X will be somewhere here, or X will be somewhere here. Okay. So because you can flip, maybe this was X should be under the X. So this way I can see how many ways I can map the triangle T into something in the complex plane, right? I decide which of these is mapped to zero, which of them is mapped to one, and then if I will be in the positive side or in the negative side. So every triangle T corresponds to up to 12 points in the complex plane. You can think of it also the other way. Whenever I here pick a point, then I connect it with 0, 1, and here is a triangle shape. Happy? Is that? Yeah. So, and then if we say almost every triangle, then we will look at the triangles that satisfy or don't satisfy the theorem. And yes, I mean, except set of Lebesgue measures, you know. So you can have some curves here or lines, right? And if the triangles are on these curves, then maybe they don't satisfy the theorem, but everyone else does, right? Okay. But now I will describe how to connect this to something that I'm more familiar with. But the trick will be that instead of studying point sets, we will study three uniform hypergraphs. Okay. So maybe let's look at the picture first. Here I have a triangle T that's fixed. And here is a point set. Now the point set is also fixed. Okay. And the point set has some triangles that are epsilon similar to the triangle T. And I will do the most natural thing that one could think of is whenever I see a triangle that is epsilon similar to T, I put a hyper edge there. Okay. So now I have these two hyper edges instead of the triangles. Right? So this G, P, T, epsilon, it will be a three uniform hypergraph, where the vertex set are the points P, and a triple is H in this hypergraph, if and only if the points A, B, C are forming a triangle that is epsilon similar to T. The simplest thing one could think of, kind of, right? translating it. And interesting, if you look at these hypergraphs that come from the point sets, they don't contain everything. Right? There are some hypergraphs that you cannot realize this way. Right? So Ivoko hypergraph forbidden, if you cannot realize it in any point set with your fixed triangle T. Right? And we only care about the forbidden ones that have at most 12 vertices, and that's because our proof don't need more than 12 vertices. Okay. And now by this script F, we denote the family of all forbidden three graphs for this point sets. Okay. I will show how to find out or check if a three graph H is actually forbidden in a little bit. I will not describe a procedure that can do it for any H, but for some H. Okay. So here are examples of graphs that are forbidden. Okay. So for example, here K4 minus is one of the forbidden ones. If you remember, I was having this triangle T with right angle, and then you could have on the four points all of the triples there. So that would be one of the almost all, that would be one of the excluded triangles. Because normally you cannot even get three triangles on four points that are all similar to triangle T. And there are a bunch of others, right? And I do not know names of these. There are just too many three uniform hypergraphs. Right? So, okay. And this is the outline of the Bárány Füredi proof, right? In one line. So I would like to know what's the maximum number of epsilon similar triangles to T on endpoints. So it's the same as looking as all point sets and creating the hypergraph on them where the triangles that are similar to T become edge and maximizing the number of edges. Okay? This is exactly the same thing. then now this is optimization over some three uniform hypergraphs. So what we can do is, instead of optimize over those hypergraphs, I will just say, oh, these were forbidden subgraphs, so I will try to optimize the number of edges. Now it's a Turán problem. Maximum number of edges in a three uniform hypergraph on vertices that doesn't contain any of these graphs as subgraphs. Okay. And this is something that is I don't want to say easy, but something that there are tools to do it, or tools to get bounds. Right? And there's the flag algebras by Rosborough. I'll say a little bit about it on next slide. Right? And what they did is they put it into Flagmatic, which is some software that can give you a bound, and they got 0.25072 times and choose. So that's what they did. And we do a similar thing, but we forbid few more hypergraphs. We have these also forbidden. And I will try to now describe why they are forbidden, or how one can argue that they may be forbidden. Okay. So I will need a nice hypergraph somehow to be able to decide it's forbidden. Okay. So I will call it dense, whatever that. Okay. And the feature is that there will be ordering of the vertices V1, V2 up to VR, such that whenever I am introducing a new vertex, there will be exactly one edge that contains it. And the last vertex is contained in two edges. Maybe I will show it on the L7, right? So here I first start with vertices 1 and 2, right? And then I have a vertex 3 that is in exactly one edge so far, right? Then I am introducing a vertex 4 that is in edge with the previous one. Right? Now I will introduce vertex 5, which is in edge with the previous one. Right? Then I am introducing vertex 6, it is in edge with previous one. 7 is in edge with previous vertices. And finally, there are two edges that contain vertex 8. So you may maybe renumber the vertices and have a different ordering, but this is what we will need. Maybe here is the same thing. I have 1, 2, 3, then here I am introducing vertex 4, and it is in, by introducing it, by having two other vertices that are in edge with it, that I already have. Then I'm introducing 5, introducing 6, introducing 7, 8, and here are two edges that contain 9. Okay. Happy? Questions? And so here is, if I have a triangle T, okay, then there are the 12 points that represent it. Okay? So one could calculate that if you have a complex number Z, then this would be the other vertices, if you want. That still get T. Okay? And what we will try to do is we take one of these graphs that I called forbidden, and then I will try to embed them on some points P1, P2, P3 in the complex numbers. Okay. So I will try to draw a picture of the procedure. Okay. So the first two entries, I will put 0 equals P1, and then 1 equals P2, right? They're the two points on the real line. And then when I am looking at the third point, it was in edge with 1, 2, right? With the first two vertices. So there are like 12 possibilities where to put P3. Right? So maybe I pick here, this would be P3, it is one of the triangles. Right? And now, how many, where I can, okay. And it is not a point where I can put P3, it's a little bit more, right? Now I have little epsilon wiggle room, so there is a little ball where I can put P3, right? And how many ways are there to put P4, right? For every possibility where I put P3, I have 12 possibilities where to put P4. Right? Because P4 will be in an edge with two previous vertices. So I have like two points that are kind of fixed. It's same as the 0, 1. And I have to find one of the 12 possibilities where to put P4. Right? So maybe if it was on edge P2, P3, then there would be like this possibilities for P4, and it would be these little balls around. And now I have 12 squared possibilities where to put P4. Okay, and maybe this epsilon changes a little bit as well. Does it make a little bit of sense? Somewhat?
Okay. So sorry, okay, Bernard, so since we are such a small group, I think I got maybe lost in the overall argument. So you have I think I just forgot about the setting. So you have this forbidden graph, which so what is the sorry?
What I am trying to do is to say, if you have the point set, there are some forbidden hypergraphs. I identify the forbidden hypergraphs, and then I just ask for a Turán problem.
So the forbidden hypergraphs are not defined for a particular point set, but you range over all point sets, and these are the hypergraphs you can't find in any of them.
Correct. I want to find hypergraphs such that if I look at any point set, maybe it will not be, it will not appear in the graph of epsilon similar triangles to triangle T. And here I am saying it will not appear for almost all. There may be triangles that I have the right angle that maybe, but for most of them, they will not appear. Did it happen?
Yes.
Please, anyone, if you have question, try to ask. And here I am trying to give some kind of argument how one can see that some of these graphs cannot appear. And I do it by saying I have a triangle shape T, and I'm trying to construct R points in the plane such that they contain the L7 or L8. Or another way, I'm trying to show that no matter how I pick the R points, they cannot contain L. Okay. And here I'm trying to see what are my options if I am trying to construct L7. Okay. And for choice of the first two points in the hypergraph L7, doesn't matter. I can scale and rotate the plane as I want. And then for every other point, if I have a hyper edge, it means that there was a triangle. And if there is a triangle that is epsilon similar to my triangle T, I only have 12 options, up to 12 options where this P3 can be, because there are like, the triangle can be there in different ways, Matt, but it must be there. Did it help a little bit? Okay. So I'm just trying to now check all the possible point sets to see if triangle T can be there. Okay. And so what we will do is that the first R minus one points, there are a bunch of possibilities how to put them in, like 12 to the R minus three. So I fix one of these possibilities. And then I look what are the options for the last point. Right? There were two edges. If you remember, there were two edges that contain the last point. And one edge will give me, these are the options for the last point PR. And the other edge gives me a different options where the last point must be. Because that's why it was important that whenever I introduce a new vertex, it is in a hyper edge with two vertices that I already have. Because then I only have 12 possibilities where to put it. Okay? And now I have to look if these red and black circles overlap, or if there is an option for me to put the PR. Right? So if they don't intersect, like in this picture, then it's saying the edge, the very last edge says point PR must be in one of these red balls, and the previous edge said that the last point must be in one of the black balls, and that is contradiction. Then you cannot realize the graph. Another option would be that You have a red ball and black ball that intersect like this. Okay. And then you could put the point PR here. Okay. And now you could realize the graph. But if you make smaller epsilon, then these balls will become disjoint and you will not be able to realize it anymore. So if you come up with some configuration where the balls intersect, but do not have the same center, then by changing epsilon, you will make them disjoint. And the last option is that maybe there is a black ball that has the same center as the red ball. And in that case, this is the point where the PR goes and the graph can be realized. Or you cannot exclude that it cannot be realized. Right? So what we have to do is for all the graphs that you want to exclude, try to see the possibilities where the first R minus one vertices can be embedded and see where the last vertex can be embedded and show that for each of the edges, you get disjoint point sets for the last vertex. All right, maybe we use some.
Sorry, Bernard. So now I'm not really sure what you meant by this last sentence, but because you can't do this checking without knowing the angles, can you?
that's a good question. What you can do is that if you manage to exclude it, exclude a graph for one triangle. There are some observations that you can exclude it for almost all of them. What we can do, what we actually do, that we just use the equilateral triangle and see what configurations we can get from that one and say, all right, these are now excluded for all the graphs. And this makes life much easier because instead of 12, we have 2 in the exponent. So this is, you are right that you would have to do it for each fixed triangle, but there are some lemmas by Bárány and Füredi that it's enough. If you show it for one triangle, then it's excluded. And this is just a sketch of a sketch. It's not even attempt for a sketch of a proof. So this was something to show how to get forbidden subgraphs, and then one can apply flag algebras. Or maybe I should say, of course, computer assisted. There is this paper from 2007 by Rasborov that introduced flag algebras, and then there was a great success of the method. Was kind of it allows to use computers to generate proofs that a little bit more involved than people can do by hand. It uses some semi-definite programming. I think it's a nice combination of computer science and mathematics. Right? And it gives results that are kind of in a limit. Maybe I will not do introduction to flag algebras here. I'll just show some examples what are they good for. Right? So they are good for optimizing density of small subgraph subject to some small set of forbidden subgraphs or constraints on small graphs. Okay? So for example, here, maximize number of K2 in K series 3 graphs. This is now normal graphs. Okay? This is Mantel's theorem. Okay? Or maximize number of five cycles in triangle three graphs. It's a R dash pentagon problem. It was a nice success story for flake algebras. Or you can try to ask what's the minimum number of triangles if the density of edges is at least p. It's a graph profiles thing. It was first done by Razborov, and now there is some exact result. If you want to read 100 pages paper and you are interested in this, that's it. Or you can formulate the Turán tetrahedron problem. Right? So you have a complete graph on four vertices, three uniform, and you are as a forbidden subgraph, and you ask what's the maximum number of edges. How many extremal contraction? The best upper bound, as far as I know, is done by Felix algebras, but it's not tight. And our case is we are maximizing the number of edges subject to some F3 graph, okay? F where the up to 12 vertices. And what we really put into computer is just some subset of the forbidden graphs from seven vertices. Kind of, yeah, 12 is too much, but seven was enough. Right? So you put something into computer and it spits a number. Right? Okay. And we do some kind of stability with this. So maybe I will try to describe what the Flake algebra actually gives us. So it tells us that now we are in three graph setting that we can find, and the graph doesn't have any of the forbidden subgraphs that comes from the point set. And we add the condition that the density of edges is at least one quarter. We are studying the extremal example, kind of, right? We hope. And the Flake algebra gives us the following conclusion, that we have edge x1, x2, x3, and this is the hyper edge. And then most of the remaining vertices can be partitioned into three sets such that these are all hyper edges. And it is, that is kind of small, right? So it's saying that the neighborhoods of these three sets of for any pair, I look at the co-degree or the co-neighborhood, right? Common neighborhood. And each of these are relatively big, 0.26n, 0.26n, 0.26n. And I partition almost all vertices. Okay? And these blobs are disjoint. I would like if these are 1/3n. Okay? That would be my goal, but that's not what we can get. We can get to 0.26, but that will be enough. Okay. So this gives us some kind of rough structure, how the graph must look like if it has at least a quarter of the edges. Okay. So here is example what one could do, right? So I would like to find edge x1, x2, x3 such that this quantity, whatever it is maximized, right? This a1, a2, a3 are the sizes of the neighborhoods. Okay. So idea, if you want to find a good edge, maybe you can pick a random edge, right? And you may be lucky. So here we pick a random edge, and this expression can be written with Flake algebras by this t to 1, I mean a blow up of an edge with sizes 2, 2, and 1. So this is just an edge, and this is a blow up of an edge such that it has sizes 3, 3, and 1. Okay. And so this is what happens if you pick a random edge. And this expression, the f is 1/4 m square, and like algebra can show it's at least 0.213. And from that you can try to optimize what are the sizes, and you can get that the sizes of AIs are at least 0.17, and the sum is at least 0.94. If you remember on the previous slide, I promised better numbers than this. So we can get a slightly different f that shows 0.244 n squared here instead of 0.22, and then we can show that the minimum is at least 0.26 and the sum is at least 0.988. And here what we did is that here you pick a random edge, and instead of random edge we pick a random blow up of an edge 2, 2, 1. And the reason why this helps is that if you look at the extremal structure, right, it has edges like this and then iterated edges inside. So if I pick a random edge and I pick edge that is going across the three parts, then I'm in a good shape. Okay? Then this f function will be large, because the neighborhoods will be large. But in the extreme example, if I pick edge that is here, then it will not be very good. And the function f, this will be kind of small. So picking edge that is inside hurts me, and there are many edges inside the iterated blow up to damage the bound. If you pick something bigger than an edge, maybe it has more vertices, then it's more likely that you pick it from the top level structure instead of the iterated part, and then you can get a better number. Yeah. And now the rest of the proof. Okay. So I will draw the picture what we kind of have. So we kind of have three blobs, and here is one edge that is there for sure. This x1, x2, x3. And then for every other vertex that is there, I know the edge exists with two of the other vertices. And then the life is not too bad, surprisingly. I would like to clean up the top layer and say that the only triangles or edges that are there are these, and that's it. Okay? Only these. And if there are edges like this, and this would be like a bad edge, I don't want to see this one. And it's actually not bad to show that one actually doesn't see it. One doesn't see it because there must be a triangle like this. Now it will be messy, right? Each of these red endpoints of the triangle must be in one of the edges. And now the whole thing here would be one of the forbidden graphs. So that makes life actually super easy. And if I have some vertex here that is outside, not partitioned, and it has some dubious edges such that it looks like maybe like this or this, then this will also be a forbidden configuration. Okay? And that's why we need to study forbidden configuration up to 12 vertices to deal with points that may be in the trash, right? So normally this is somehow tricky thing with this iterated method when one has to say, oh, if there is edge, I will flip it, and then the number of whatever I'm looking for increases, or things like that. And here we just error. If the edge that is there and we don't want it there, then we have a forbidden subgraph. So here is the result that the Fleck algebra and this stability does is that we can partition the vertices of the graph G that has the forbidden subgraphs that came from the point set into three sets, x1, x2, x3. Now it's actually a partition, and there are no edges that look like this. There are no edges that are two points in one block and other point in a different block. The only edges that are there are edges that touch all three of these point sets, or edges that are living inside, right? Inside they can, if we don't have a control over them. And that's the main term in the recursive formula. Right? The recursive formula says use the three equal sizes and then whatever is inside. Okay. And then here is some little proof sketch. What's the number of edges in the graph G? It's the number of cross edges plus the number of edges inside. And then one could get from induction, maybe if I want to show 1/24 n³ plus big C times n, that this would be the result. Okay. And so in the end, we get 1/24 n³ plus some linear term. Okay. And now one can try to optimize this, and you can say when is the thing the largest, and it's some polynomial that you optimize, and you can show that it should be balanced. It's kind of what one expects. These things, either they are balanced or as unbalanced as you can. So here, the balanced thing is. All right. So that was the technical part of the proof. And here is the outline of the proof, kind of, again. It's the same as the Füredi Bárány proof. That I would like to maximize the number of epsilon similar triangles. Instead of looking at triangles, I look at three uniform hypergraphs that come from the point sets and try to maximize the number of edges. We look at these three uniform hypergraphs and we are able to identify some set of forbidden hypergraphs that are there. We call them script F, and then we ask for the Turán density for this family F, and with Fleck algebra and some stability, we can show it's most 1/4 and tell you the top level structure. Yeah. So the actual theorem is this recursive formula, that the maximum number is A times B times C, where they are as equal as possible, and inside each of the block, you do recursively whatever was the best in there. And it works for n big enough. At some point, the Fleck algebra calculations stop working. So then, yeah. Who knows? And if you have n as a power of 3, then you are lucky because you can take a small configuration, blow it up, and get an argument that even the small configuration was just the balance blow up of a triangle. So if n is power of 3, we know exactly. It's often the case with proofs that come with like algebras that you get something for big N, and if the N is a good power, you can blow up a small structure and kind of get the thing for free without much extra work. Okay, so that was the proof and result part. I will now spend a little bit on open problems about it. People sometimes like it. So let's see. This is Theo. He is a nephew of Felix. Okay? And he has these magnet tiles. And what Theo's trying to do is to put as many of the magnet tiles together in 3D. So what you could do is consider point sets that are in 3D or R to the D. You don't have to do just plane. If you are adventurous, you can wander into other dimensions. Okay. And the question is now same. Okay. What's the maximum number of epsilon similar triangles to T if T is small enough? You could try to do the similar approach as we did by finding a set of forbidden graphs and see if the Turán problem will make sense. Okay. Or if you find enough of small ones, maybe. Okay. So here is an example, but you can try. Here is a triangle. Okay. And if you would cut it along the lines and bend it along these lines, you will get a pyramid, and every side of this pyramid will be a copy of this triangle, of this big triangle. It will be epsilon similar. So you could get 4 points in 3D such that every triple is epsilon similar triangle to the triangle T. And if you remember the Füredi, they showed that K for 3 minus is a forbidden subgraph. So you cannot even have 3 in 2D. Right? So it's a, in 3D, you can get more. If the angles are not all acute, then maybe if there is an obtuse triangle angle, it will not work. Right? If you try to do the same trick, it will not fold. So then now the angles will maybe matter more. There will be different answers. Okay. The observation is that if you have an acute triangle, then you can get at least 2/5 by just taking this kind of simplex, shift it, and iterating the blow up of it. But we do not know if that's the best or not. Maybe it is, maybe it is not. Okay. And this 1/4 that we got from Fleck algebras, there was a bunch of forbidden subgraphs, and it contained K for minus and C5. And there's a conjecture of Falgas Ravi and ML Faughan that you don't need to forbid all of those. It may be just forbidding 2 is good enough. And we think that maybe instead of C5, one can put there L2, and that should also give 1/4. We saw that L2 would be better to forbid than C5 because it was somewhat more useful in building the extrema construction. So maybe either of those. And then, of course, there are more questions you can try to ask. How is it with all of the triangles or other shapes? Right. So, hey, thank you for coming today. I hope you enjoyed it at least a little bit.
Thank you, Bernard. That was a really nice talk. So, are there any questions from the audience? Maybe Honza, please.
Yeah, so I mean, just to confirm, I didn't misunderstand something. So this one quarter that you also get from simply forbidding C5 minus and C5 minus only, but it would not be that much related because C5 minus is actually not a forbidden for this geometric problem. Did I understood correctly, or did I digest everything correctly?
I don't remember right now if the C5 was minus was forbidden or not. But we can check. If it was forbidden, then Füredi has it. C5 minus is also forbidden.
I see. Okay. Well, then.
So maybe it would be enough to just forbid C5. Minus.
Okay. Yeah. Then just saying that you can, in principle, do it just with one forbid C5 minus.
Okay.
Which sure, actually, sure. I mean, that actually forbidding C5 minus trivially forbids C5, and by an easy argument, it also forbids K4 minus. So,
okay,
inequality between the extreme numbers is just okay, whatever. But then I'm just saying a remark. You can also forbid C5 minus.
Okay, I'll fix it over here.
Thanks.
So just a question, if I remember from the beginning of the talk, so what you can do, you can, or what people can do, you have now this result for almost all triangles, but then there are these special triangles, right, like the right angled one. And so you don't know any characterization. So would this probably machinery Füredi and Bárány developed, could you look at the triangle and say, at least at some triangles, could you say, well, my result applies?
So you want to say, if you give me a triangle, will the result apply? Sure, well, you could do that. You look at the triangle and see if the forbidden graphs that it generates are the same one that we used, and then it will apply. If you are asking me about, here is the triangle.
Right, because you could do this 12 to the r minus. What would, right? So you would really, with that triangle, you would try sort of to generate these configurations.
Yes.
Right, so which is a finite procedure, not that horrible, like 12 to the 12 or something, right?
Yeah, it's not pleasant, but you could check if you like. So there is some, what actually happens is that if you want to decide if the graph is forbidden or not, you can try to write what are the points that are allowed for the last point, and it will be some polynomials. So you could check it by solving some polynomial equations. See if it has solution or not. But I would check with the 12 to the 12. And I think that if it doesn't have a right angle, and if it doesn't have, if all three sides have different length, then I think the result will apply. It's my guess, no proof. So the ones there, the trouble happen if you have the right angle.
Okay.